Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. Well, good morning. Doorkeepers will please close the doors and keep them closed. We will have scripture reading and prayer by the chaplain, after which we will pledge allegiance to the flag of our country. Our chaplain this morning will be introduced by the representative from the 75th House District, Representative Yasmin Neal. Representative Neal.
Thank you. Good morning, members. It's my honor today to introduce my good friend and pastor, Rakia Mathis. Rakia Mathis is a native of Atlanta, Georgia. She holds a Bachelor of Science degree in Early Childhood Education from Valdosta State University and a Master's of Arts degree in Christian Education from Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Her late father, Apostle Charles Mathis, was diagnosed with cancer in 2006 and soon passed after. Pastor Rakia then began to prepare herself for the calling of God that had placed, the calling that God had placed on her life to become a pastor and succeed her father. She has traveled extensively across the nation on mission trips to Georgetown, Guyana, and Suriname, spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ. She's been a pastor for 5 years at Emmanuel Light of the World Christian Church in College Park, and she is also a first grade elementary school teacher at Eddie J. White Academy in Hampton, Georgia, in Clayton County. It's actually a funny story how we met, because we were at Valdosta State, and we were in the dorms and had two subpar roommates. Her roommate was stealing her items from her when she left for the weekend, and mine was just the spawn of the devil. And so after doing residency housing counseling, they actually ended up putting our two roommates together and putting me and her together. We've never split since then. So it's my honor to bring to you my good friend, Pastor Rakia Mathis.
Good morning. Oh, we can do better than that. Good morning. I'm so honored to be here this morning. I look at this as being such a privilege and such an honor. I'm so humbled. And I want to thank the Speaker of the House and also the members of the House as well for allowing me to come in and share God's word with you this morning. You know, I've been a pastor for 5 years, and before becoming a pastor, I understood my purpose in life. I understood my call. I understood that I was called into pastoral leadership. And so when I realized that, I said, okay, I need to go to college. I need to go to seminary. I need to learn everything that I need to know about the Bible. If I'm going to be a pastor, I need to know about God's word, right? And after studying and studying and studying, I went to Oral Roberts University and studied Christian education, and I felt that I was equipped for the call. But after becoming a pastor and dealing with people and issues, I realized that there were some things that school didn't teach me about handling these issues. And so I found myself praying and asking God for his wisdom. I said, Lord, I need your wisdom to be able to handle this leadership position, to be able to lead your people, to be able to be a great pastor at Emmanuel Light of the World. And oftentimes when I'm praying for the leadership of Georgia and the leaders here, I pray for you. I pray that God would give you all wisdom and give you all knowledge, because the word tells us that we ought to pray for those who are in authority over us, that we may live peaceable lives in all godliness and honesty. And not only do I pray for you all, but I pray for myself that God would continue to increase his wisdom in me. Because I've realized that without his wisdom, sometimes I'm not able, in my own knowledge, able to fully work in that leadership position effectively. You know, I thought about King Solomon in the Bible. And King Solomon was a very young king, very young. And God said, whatever you wish, I will give it to you. And now most people would ask God for fortune and ask God for fame and ask God for long life and good health. But King Solomon asked God for wisdom. He says, if you just give me wisdom, then I will know how to lead your people effectively. He says, if you just give me wisdom, because I know that you've placed me in this position as king. And I know because you've placed me here, I want to do a great job. And if you would just give me your wisdom, then I know that I will be an effective leader for your people. And that's exactly what God did. God gave him wisdom. You know, our understanding of wisdom is very different than God's understanding of wisdom. The wisdom of man has limitations. The wisdom of man is limited to what we can only see. It's limited to what we only know. If we learned it in school, then we know it. And when people operate in man's wisdom alone, I often feel like we put ourselves in a box. We put ourselves in a box and we can only go as far as our knowledge will take us. And I've understood that going to school, I'm saying, okay, I've learned these things in school, but I can only go as far as what I've learned. But God says, I want to give you a wisdom, my wisdom, so that you will be able to see beyond what you think your mind is capable of doing and thinking. The wisdom of God is not only what is seen, but the wisdom of God is also being able to see the unseen, being able to know things that are not known by man. And I believe that as leaders, God wants to show us things. He wants to give us a spiritual view and outlook of things because we're special. We're called. Each and every one of us have been called to this appointed place. It's not by chance that you all are here. It's not by chance that you all are here. And oftentimes we're faced with great problems and great issues and great situations, and we're having to make decisions and having to make choices. And sometimes we have the education and we have the skills and the experience to carry out the task at hand. But what I've learned is that oftentimes that's not enough. Oftentimes it's not enough. People say, well, if you have gray hair, then you must have wisdom. Is that right? You know, if you have a lot of gray hair, then you have wisdom. So in whatever leadership position that we have or that we hold, we were ultimately placed there because God placed us there to carry out his purpose. You know, knowledge means that you know a lot. And I believe that every last one of us in here, we know a lot about what we do as leaders. But wisdom, when we operate with the wisdom of God, it comes with a discernment. It comes with a discernment. It allows you to see things that God wants his leaders to see, to be able to make the right decisions and to be able to make the right choices for his people. God's wisdom and knowledge go hand in hand. Oftentimes we want to use one without the other, but they go together. In fact, they work well together. Our knowledge and God's wisdom, they go together. But the thing about man's wisdom alone, when we're operating through knowledge alone and just man's wisdom alone, sometimes it can come across a little arrogant. Sometimes it can come across and create faction and dissension among people. Instead of bringing people together, sometimes man's wisdom alone can drive people apart. Instead of producing peace in a situation, sometimes man's wisdom can produce strife. It can produce discord and disharmony. But the special thing about operating with God's wisdom is that the word says in James 3:17, it says God's wisdom is pure. It is peaceable. It brings peace to situations. It is gentle. It is reasonable. It is full of mercy and good fruit. It is unwavering and without hypocrisy. That's the type of wisdom that he desires for us to operate in so that we can get things done for his glory. The wisdom of God is what he will bless us with in order for us to glorify him in our leadership. You know, I believe as leaders, we have a desire to benefit the people who we serve. But our ultimate desire should be to bring God glory through our leadership and his wisdom. James 1:5 says, and I'm closing with this verse, but James 1:5 says, if any man lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives it to all men generously and without reproach. Wisdom is a gift. And he says, all we have to do as leaders is ask for it. And he says, I will give it to you without reservations. I will release it unto you because I have appointed you as leaders of this great state of Georgia. And there's a job that has to be done. And there's some things that he wants to show us. There are some ways in which he wants to direct us as leaders. And I truly believe that one word from God, one bright idea, one revelation, that's all it takes to change a society. Thank you. Could you please stand? Lord God, we just thank you, Father, for the leaders, Lord God, that you have appointed in this season, Father. Lord God, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for the wisdom in which you have given each and every one of us. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, that we're operating from the same mind and from the same spirit. We thank you, Lord God, that there's no division among us, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, that there's no discord among us, Father, that we operate in harmony and peace, Lord God, because we know that your wisdom brings peace, it brings gentleness, and it brings all the characteristics of who you are. And so, God, I thank you, Father, Lord God, that your peace, Lord God, and your wisdom would rest upon your people today. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Doorkeepers will unlock the doors. Chair recognizes the Chairman of the Committee on Information and Audits, the representative from the 109th District, Chairman Davis.
Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Information and Audits has read and reviewed the journal from the previous legislative day and found it to be correct.
Chairman Davis, the Chair of the Committee on Information and Audits, reports that the journal of the previous legislative day has been read and found to be correct. Is there any objection to the confirmation of the journal? The chair hears none, and the journal is confirmed. The clerk will read the resolution establishing the order of business for the day.
Mr. O'Neill, the 146th, moves the following be established. The order of business in the first part of period unanimous consents. Introduction of bills and resolutions. First reading of reference of bills and resolutions. Second reading of bills and resolutions. Reports of standing committees. Third reading and passage of uncontested local bills. Rules calendar. Privilege resolutions through the resolution.
Is there any objection to the adoption of the resolution establishing the order of business for the day? The chair hears none and the resolution is adopted. First reading of House bills and resolutions. The clerk will read.
House Bill 864, Representative Harbin, 118th. A bill of entitled Act, entitled 48, an imposition rate collection, assessment, sales, and use taxes.
Ways and Means.
House Bill 865, Representative Powell, 29th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 40 relating to the identification and regulation of motor vehicles.
Motor vehicles.
House Bill 866, Representative Bryan, 160th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 40 relating to prestige license plates.
Motor vehicles.
House Bill 867, Representative Peake, 137th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 3 relating to alcoholic beverages.
Regulated industries.
House Bill 868, Representative Collins, 27th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 48 relating to imposition, computation, exemption, state income tax.
Ways and Means.
House Bill 869, Representative Lane, 167th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 27 relating to game and fish.
Game, fish, and parks.
House Bill 870, Representative Battles, 15th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 43 relating to residential general contractors.
Regulated industries.
House Bill 871, Representative Battles, 15th. Bill will be entitled Act Amendment Code Section 1521-179 relating to additional penalties for violation of traffic laws.
Judiciary non-civil.
House Bill 872, Representative Shaw, 176th. Bill will be entitled Act Amendment Title 10 relating to secondary metals recyclers.
Judiciary non-civil.
House Bill 873, Representative Reese of the 11th. Bill will be entitled Act Amendment Title 48 on imposition rate computation income tax.
Ways and Means.
House Bill 874, Representative Reese, the 11th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 20 relating to discipline of students.
Education.
House Bill 875, Representative Knight, 126th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Code Section 2713 relating to ownership and custody of wildlife.
Game, fish, and parks.
House Resolution 1239, Representative Manning, 32nd, a resolution urging the cities of Marietta, Atlanta, and Jonesboro to recognize the Gone with the Wind Trail.
Economic Development and Tourism.
Senate Bill 302 by Senator Staten of the 18th. Bill to be entitled Act Amendment Title 20 relating to Georgia Higher Education Facilities Authority.
Higher Education.
Through the first readers.
Second reading of House bills and resolutions. The clerk will read.
HB 669 by Representative Clark of the 98th, the bill relating to organization of the executive branch. HB 677 by Representative Holcomb of the 82nd, bill relating to general provisions for members of the General Assembly. HB 846 by Representative Knight of the 126th, bill relating to revenue and taxation. HB 847 by Representative Maddox of the 172nd, a bill to amend an act creating Board of Commissioners, County of Grady. HB 848 by Representative Dixon of the 6th, bill to amend an act shortening the terms of office and providing for the election of members of the Board of Education, Whitfield County. HB 849 by Representative Amerson of the 9th, bill relating to local authorization regulations for manufacturer distribution package sales of distilled spirits. HB 850 by Representative Harrell of the 106th, a bill relating to court proceedings involving guardian and ward. HB 851 by Representative Rice of the 51st, bill relating to reports and distributions regarding the taxation of intangibles. HB 852 by Representative Rice of the 51st, bill relating to consumer fees to implement provisions of Article 28 relating to the Georgia Lemon Law. HB 853 by Representative Earhart of the 36th, a bill relating to general provisions relative to agriculture. HB 854 by Representative Hamilton of the 23rd, a bill to amend the Small Business Assistance Act of 1975. HB 855 by Representative Hamilton of the 23rd, a bill relating to Universal Access Fund, HB 856 by Representative Scott of the 76th, a bill relating to students in elementary and secondary education, HB 857 by Representative Scott of the 76th, a bill relating to consultation by the Department of Early Care and Learning on early care and education programs and other matters, HB 858 by Representative Rogers of the 26th, a bill relating to motor vehicles and traffic, HB 859 by Representative Sims of the 169th, a bill relating to suspension and removal of local school board members under certain circumstances, HB 860 by Representative Harder of the 175th, bill to amend an act providing for number of members of the election of members of Board of Education in Lowndes County, HB 861 by Representative Harden of the 28th, a bill relating to law enforcement officers, HB 862 by Representative Martin of the 47th, a bill relating to imposition rate and computation of income and taxes and exemptions, HB 863 by Representative Hatchett of the 143rd, a bill relating to state purchasing, H.R. 1237 by Representative Martin of the 47th, resolution urging the federal government to cease collection of motor fuel taxes in Georgia, Senate Bill 136 by Senator Hamrick of the 30th, bill relating to specialized land transaction, SB 300 by Senator Bullock of the 11th, a bill relating to definitions relative to alteration and misbranding of food, SB 301 by Senator Bullock of the 11th, a bill relating to general provisions regarding hunting, SB 307 by Senator Leggan Jr. of the 3rd, a bill relating to licenses, permits, tags, and stamp fees, SB 309 by Senator Jeffers of the 17th, a bill relating to hunting, trapping, or fishing licenses, permits, and stamps generally, through second readers.
Report of standing committees. The clerk will read.
Representative McCall, 30th, Chairman of the Committee on Agriculture and Consumer Affairs, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Agriculture and Consumer Affairs has had consideration of the following bills. The House struck me to report the same back to the House with the following recommendations. House Bill 409, 832, do pass. House Bill 681, do pass by substitute. Respectfully submitted, Representative McCall, Chairman. Representative England, 108, Chairman of the Committee on Appropriations, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Appropriations, having consideration of following bills, the House struck to report the same back to the House final recommendation. House Bill 806, House Bill 741, do pass by committee substitute. Respect submitted. Representative England, Chairman. Representative Cooper, the 41st, Chairman of the Committee on Health and Human Services, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Health and Human Services, having consideration of the following bill, the Senate instructed me to report the same back to the House with the following recommendation. Senate Bill 183, do pass. Respect submitted. Representative Cooper, Chair. Representative Sims, 169, Chairman of the Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, your Committee on Intergovernmental Coordination, having consideration of the following bills, the House instructed me to report the same back to the House following recommendation. House Bill 753, 73, 764, 765, 784, do pass by substitute. House Bill 803, do pass. House Bill 812, House Bill 815, do pass by substitute. House Bill 823, do pass. Submitted, Representative Sims, Chairman. Representative Golick, 34th, District Chairman, Committee on Judiciary and Non-Civil, submitted the following report. Mr. Speaker, Committee on Judiciary and Non-Civil, sending consideration of following bills and resolution of the House, instructed to move the same back to the House following recommendation. House Bill 342 do pass by substitute. House Bill 648 do pass. House Resolution 977 do pass by substitute. Respect submitted. Representative Golick, Chairman. Representative Williams, the 4th, Chairman of Committee on Regulated Industries, submit the following report. Mr. Speaker, Committee on Regulated Industries, having consideration of the following bills, the House struck the report, the same back to the House following recommendation. House Bill 814 do pass. House Bill 166 do pass by substitute. Respect is submitted. Representative Williams, Chairman, through the committee reports.
Okay, we're going on to the local calendar. Third reading and passage of uncontested local bills. The chair has decided that we've got several distinguished Georgians that we're going to recognize and honor here this morning, but I need an occasion to have you return to your desk, and I think the local calendar is probably a pretty good way to do that. So after we vote, I'm going to ask you to remain close by your seats because we're going to come to order. If there's no objection, we will vote on the local calendar as a whole with a recorded vote. Hearing none, it is so ordered. The clerk will read the local calendar.
House Bill 753 by substitute by Representative Holmes, 125th Jasper County. House Bill 753 by substitute by Representative Holmes, 125th Jasper County. House Bill 764 by substitute by Representative Lane, 167th McIntosh County. House Bill 765 by substitute by Representative Lane, 167th McIntosh County. House Bill 784 by substitute by Representative Maxwell, 17th Harrelson County. House Bill 803 by Representative Ralston, 7th Gilmer County. House Bill 812 by substitute by Representative Henry, 67th Douglas County. House Bill 815 by substitute by Representative Kidd, 141st Baldwin County. House Bill 823 by Representative Welch, 110th Henry County, through the local calendar.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the passage of the bills? The chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall these bills now pass? All those in favor of the passage of the bills on the local calendar will vote yes. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machines. On the passage of the bills on the local calendar, the ayes are 155, the nays are zero. These bills, having received the requisite constitutional majority, are therefore passed. The chair recognizes the chairman of the Rules Committee for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the Rules Committee, there will be a Rules Committee meeting right this second, right out there. It'll take just a minute of your time. Thank you.
We're going on to invite resolutions now. This house will come to order. House will come to order. Chair recognizes Representative Maddox for an invite resolution. And Representative Maddox.
You see your veterinarian up there, don't you?
Yes, I'm one of them.
Yeah, Dr. Zager. Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Today is Veterinarians Day at the Capitol, and having been a member of this group for over 50 years, I'm pleased to welcome them to our assembly. I thank the Lord he gave me a profession I thoroughly enjoyed, and having practiced 45 years before and elected to the House, veterinary medicine is very special to me. I'm sure that many of you House members today have your personal vet here, including Speaker Ralston's friend and vet, Dr. Mike Zager. Please help me welcome them. Dr. Zager, wave at him. Oh, yeah. Ask the clerk if he would to please read the resolution.
House Resolution 1132 by Representative Maddox, 172nd. A resolution recognizing February 2nd, 2012 as Veterinary Medicine Day at the State Capitol and inviting representatives from the Georgia veterinary medical community to be recognized by this House of Representatives.
Okay. I'd like to introduce to you now Dr. Spencer Talley, who's the president of the Georgia Veterinary Medical Association, and ask him to say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Maddox. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and members of the House of Representatives for the privilege of speaking to you today. As president of the Georgia Veterinary Medical Association, I am here to represent the GVMA, the voice of the veterinary medical profession in legislative matters, as well as the authority on animal health issues in Georgia. Since 1906, the GVMA has been serving Georgia's veterinary community, which today consists of more than 3,300 licensed veterinarians in clinical practice, teaching and research, regulatory medicine, public health, and military service. As the other family doctor, today's veterinarians are the only medical professionals educated to protect the health of both animals and people. Perhaps this is why consumer surveys consistently rank veterinarians among the most respected professionals in America. They work hard to address the health needs of every species of animal, and they also play a critical role in agribusiness, Georgia's largest economic sector. In addition to environmental protection, food safety, animal welfare, and public health. Again, thank you for your time. And before I leave, I would like to make a simple request. When considering any legislation pertaining to animal and public health in this or any session, I would encourage every member of this assembly to talk to your veterinary constituents for a factual and science-based perspective. Veterinarians are the voice of reason in the animal welfare community. Thank you.
Good job. Let's get a picture up here. House will remain at order, please. House will remain in order. Chair recognizes the Speaker Pro Tem of the House for an invite resolution. Speaker Pro Tem Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to ask the clerk to read a resolution recognizing and commending Georgia State on Georgia State Day.
House Resolution 1224, Representative Jones, 46th, a resolution commending Georgia State University recognizing February 2nd, 2012 as Georgia State University Day at the State Capitol and inviting President Mark Becker, his wife Laura Bassett, Coach Bill Curry, Athletic Director Cheryl Levick, and Senior Advisor to the President Tom Lewis to be recognized by this House of Representatives.
Thank you, Mr. Clerk. I hope y'all will join me today in commending Georgia State. It's Georgia State Day, and thanks to them, you have a small memento on your desk to remind you of the important role that Georgia State plays, not just in Atlanta, but statewide. I didn't know this, but Georgia State opened its doors in 1913 with 48 students, and they are now one of the largest universities in Georgia with 32,000 students from all over Georgia. Each one of us have constituents there. I want to welcome President Mark Becker, his wife Laura, the Athletic Director Cheryl Levick, and Senior Advisor Tom Lewis, and of course, last but maybe first, Coach Bill Curry of the football team, here to just say a couple words and remind us just how important Georgia State is to every one of us. Thank you.
Well, thank you and good morning. It's a real honor to represent Georgia State University in this august body. Appreciate the recognition. Thank you. Thank you. They always do this? It's a real honor to be here with you, and to have 16 of our alums in this august body is an honor. We're proud of each and every one of them. We're proud to be here at the legislature today at the General Assembly. Hope that you will have an opportunity this morning to be with our folks. And we just want you to know, we know that you're got a tight schedule. You want to be out of here by the end of March. But as you go about your business, you can count on Georgia State University to do as much and even more than any other university in this state for Complete College Georgia. We are definitely committed to recruiting, retaining, and graduating more Georgians each and every year. That's what we're all about. Thank you so much.
Well, it's not Georgia State Day without having Coach Curry say a couple words. Coach Curry.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I first moved around this room when I was 12 years old. That was 57 years ago. And so much has changed, most of it for the good. There are a lot of folks sitting here today that weren't welcome in these quarters in those times. And so it's exciting to see that. It's exciting to be a part of doing something that we hope will benefit not only Georgia State University, but downtown Atlanta and the state in general by creating a football program of which you can be proud because of academic excellence, honor in the classroom, discipline on and off the field, and most importantly, graduates that will make this a better state and a better world in which to live. That's our goal, and that's lofty talk, but we work at it all day, every day. We appreciate your kindness and support, and we hope you'll continue. God bless you. Thank you.
House will remain at order. We're about to go on to morning orders. If you have them, if you have signed up for a morning order, then I would ask you to come on down to the front, and we have a number of people who have signed up. Now, before we go to morning orders, I understand that we have the doctor of the day on the floor. Chair is going to recognize Representative Peek to introduce the doctor of the day.
How you doing? Good, good. Good morning. I'm proud today to introduce Dr. Rana Muna, who from Macon, who
did her studies at Mercer University, completed her residency at Atlanta Medical Center. She's president-elect of the Bibb County Medical Society. This is her third time serving as our doctor of the day, so she's a veteran with us, and one of her proudest accomplishments is that her son, Christian, recently returned from his second tour of duty in Afghanistan, and we're glad to have him back home. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Muna.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Alan, for introducing me. Glad to see face from home. I'm here on behalf of the Bibb County Medical Society to tell you that we appreciate you. We know you're away from home, you're away from your families, and we know that you're helping us protect physician autonomy and that sacrosanct relationship with our patients. We're also here to tell you that our eyes are on you. We know who you are, what you're voting for. We're very interested. We get emails every day. And believe me, in between seeing patients, I'm keeping up to date with what's going on here. Thank you so much. If you're sick, come and see me. If you'd like to lose a little weight, I can help you with that too.
We all can use that.
Okay, we're going on to morning orders. Chair recognizes Chairman Stevens for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think it's real appropriate that a doctor of the day mention exactly that, that the eyes are on you, and I appreciate the comment. And with that, I'd like to just mention something that happened yesterday that just got my attention, and I apologize for being a little bit contrary, but yesterday we got a little comments about Delta Airlines and the 1,200 employees that might have been let go. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you those people were early retirement, just to clear the air. And while I'm here, just to let you know that the, and I appreciate Southwest Airline coming to Georgia and making some jobs here. That's a really, really big deal. Gives competition. But the rest of the story is, they're starting out, Delta is $80 million a year in the hole. Because in Texas, there's no sales tax on jet fuel. And in 1 year, ladies and gentlemen, Delta spent $3 billion, with a B, more in fuel. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got to level the playing field for our businesses here. But most importantly, whenever we come to this well, I would plead with you, whenever we're making comments, let's make sure the number one reason we keep businesses in Georgia, it's not tax abatements, it's not education. The number one reason they're here is they want to know that we want them. And for here, as chairman of this committee, I'm telling Delta Airlines, we want you in Georgia and we want to keep you here. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes the minority leader of the House for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And with your permission, I'd like to ask all the women wearing red today to join me down at the well. And if you're not wearing red but you meant to, you can also join us.
Come on. Come on.
Oh, that's right. Well, thank you, Mr. Speaker. Tomorrow, February 3rd, is National Go Red Day. It's National Wear Red Day, but being in Georgia, we're a little bit ahead of the curve. They have not been able to join us yet, but we want to go ahead and recognize the importance of heart disease research and efforts that are being undertaken by the American Heart Association. I have a few facts for you. Did you know that 419,000 American women, one per minute, die from heart disease? 52% of all cardiovascular disease deaths occur in females, and 60% of all stroke death victims are women. 26% of women die within a year of suffering a heart attack, unlike 19% of men. Given the fact that heart disease is the leading cause of death, it takes 52% of the women who have heart disease dying before we decided to pay attention. More women die of heart disease, stroke, and all other cardiovascular diseases than the next three leading causes combined, including all cancers. Yet only 16% of women surveyed in 2009 considered cardiovascular disease to be their greatest health risk. Women are less likely to call 911, they're less likely to seek treatment after symptoms, and they're less likely to receive the health care that they need. February has been designated as American Heart Month, and we stand together to go red for women, the American Heart Association's national call to increase awareness. If you're standing with us today, you already received the call, and if you're not, please help us ring the bell. Go red for women, help women save their lives. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I invite everyone to sign the resolution.
Chair recognizes Representatives Tankersley, Parrish, and Burns for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We stand before you today to recognize Jenny Lynn Anderson from Statesboro, Georgia. She has successfully published a book, Room 939, 15 Minutes of Horror, 20 Years of Healing. She is here today to speak in the rotunda at noon for Stop Violence Against Women Day. Jenny Lynn's book is an inspiring story of how she survived a brutal sexual assault in 1990 while attending a national convention in an Atlanta hotel. It is an account of how tragedy turned into triumph. Jenny Lynn shares the agony of her futile attempts to achieve restoration on her own. 2 decades of searching for the release from her suffering finally led her to the spiritual truths that eventually freed her from bondage. Jenny Lynn, we salute your courage to step up and publish your story. We offer you our support and encouragement as you share your journey with other victims. Our sincere desire that they would hear your simple message of faith. Follow me, you can do it. Would you, fellow House members, join us in welcoming Jenny Lynn and her amazing husband, Mark, in the gallery this morning.
Chair recognizes Chairman Cooper for a morning order. Chairman Cooper.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, it seems to be a day to talk about health. And none of us like to go to the doctor. And we are especially, there's one group that we especially don't like to hear that we're being sent to for referrals, and that's our surgeons. But they are an extremely important group when you need them. And so today we have a group of surgeons with us. They are members of the American Society, the Georgia Society of the American College of Surgeons. And I greatly appreciate them being here. And I would like for you to recognize them, and I would like for them to stand in the balcony, please. Thank you for your service to the citizens of Georgia. And if any of you are general surgeons, I especially thank you. For several years, we did not recognize the general surgeons as a specialty. We corrected that a couple of years ago. So thank you, especially if you're a general surgeon. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The chair recognizes Chairman Smyre and the Minority Caucus Whip, Representative Hughley, for a morning order.
Good morning, Mr. Speaker. We stand on behalf of the Columbus delegation to recognize a group of young people from Columbus. It is the Columbus Youth Advisory Council. There are 76 members and they represent all of our middle and high schools. We have the president, Alex Ridley, from Brookstone, and he's a junior, and the advisor is Ms. Lisa Goodwin, who is the deputy city manager. And we'd like for them to stand. They're up in the balcony, and let's greet them warmly this morning. Also, Mr. Speaker, we have two special young ladies in that group, Sasha Belt and Adriana Embers, is sharing their 17th birthday here at the Capitol with us, and we salute them also this morning. And finally, Mr. Speaker, we have a distinguished Georgian who is a member of this group. She's an advisor to this group. And she is an actress, and she landed a role as young Renee Jackson on the original Lifetime series Any Day Now. And she relocated to California at age 12, and she spent 3 seasons on the show. She's been recognized by the NAACP Image Awards, the Young Artist and Viewer's Voice Award. She has portrayed young Halle Gilmore in the film The Painting. And most recently, she has been seen on BET in the comedy Let's Stay Together as Rhonda. And we are so delighted that during her off season from working as an actress, she works with our young people in Columbus. And she's in the gallery with us today. And her name is Shari Perry. And we want to welcome her to the Capitol this morning.
As chairman of the Muskogee County Columbus delegation, welcome to your state capitol. We're delighted to have you all here. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Randall for a morning order.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise this morning just a little bit disappointed. I've been around here 12 years, and we work together. Sometimes we disagree, but we always are civil to each other, and we respect each other. For the last several days, I've been getting solicitation from advocates on my personal email account. The email where my parents email me when I'm in session and they need to say something important, where my nieces that are out of town email me when I'm in session. And you know, I erased one because there were so many emails from advocates on a certain bill. And I'm downright upset. 12 years and this has never happened. Now I tell you, this didn't come from an advocate group, this came from somebody here. And, you know, the devil in me said, you ought to take every sponsor on that bill and write their personal address and phone number on every bathroom wall and every MARTA station in this city. But I'm not going to do that. What I am asking is that you know who you are. And if you sent personal email addresses to an advocacy group, can you email them and tell them to stop? We have email addresses, official email addresses, on the website. It says Georgia General Assembly. And that's what should be used. I welcome hearing from advocates. One member told me over in the ante room, she's so upset. She's got an email address, and she's getting so many advocate emails that it's just locked up her email. So that means her children can't email her that are out of town. That means her family out of town are sending things and it's bouncing back. Now we gotta do better than this by each other. And it's totally wrong. 12 years I've been here, and this has never happened. Same email address. But if you email me on my official legislative email, you'll get a response. I make sure of it. But let's not do this to each other. And you know who you are. You know if you have advocates coming after us about a bill that you're concerned about. And honestly, you're hurting your bill. Some folks told me at dinner last night, I don't even care what the bill is. I'm voting against it now. So I'm asking from one colleague to another, if you know you sent out a list of personal emails and cell phones, email that same person and say, please don't do that. Go on our official website and email us there. That's what it's for. And let's stop disrupting our personal lives. I think we owe that to each other as colleagues. It's just downright respect for one another. And this act that someone, and I'm gonna say it's a mistake. I wouldn't think that one of us would be that callous to the other one. I'm gonna say it's a mistake. Make it right, fix it. Email that same group you sent that doggone list of personal email addresses to and tell them to stop. If you'll do that for me, I'd certainly appreciate it. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Kendrick for a morning order. Representative Kendrick.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Colleagues, you have a flyer on your desk. I'm not going to go into the details of it, but I would point to reason number three. You can make your own personal judgments about the people that you serve with based on their pet names, but do take a look at that flyer because I think you'll find it interesting. The reason that I am standing here today is because today is Domestic Violence Day, and I have some special guests in the gallery that I would like to recognize. Mr. Roderick Cunningham is the founder of the Beverly Cunningham Outreach Program, and this program was inspired by the life of his mother, an extraordinary woman who passed away after being a victim of domestic violence. The mission began to develop her legacy and to share the heart she possessed continued throughout his demonstration of love for her. And so her son, Roderick Cunningham, felt the pressing need to pass along the love she both felt for all children, and he became the vision for the Beverly Cunningham Outreach Program. And he hopes the number of children that he reaches through this vision will forever keep the memory of his beloved mother, Beverly, alive. So if you could stand and give him a round of applause, we have Beverly Cunningham, who is in the gallery today, and recognize him for all his great efforts. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Chair recognizes Representative Scott for an invite resolution. Representative Scott.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I would like for you to join me in welcoming the only Milken educator of 2011 from Clayton County, Ms. Shakima Silvery, and her husband William, her father, and her four kids. Is he gonna read this? Mr. Clerk, please, could you please read the invite?
House Resolution 1178, Representative Scott of the 76th, a resolution honoring Shakima Silvery for being recognized with the Milken Educator Award and inviting her to be recognized by the House of Representatives at a date and time to be designated by the Speaker of this House.
Ms. Siverick is a language arts teacher at Mount Zion High School in Clayton County. She truly loves what she does on a daily basis. She is not only a teacher to her students, she is a mother and father to most of them. She tells her students every day she loves them and wants them to return ready to work the next day. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, the Milken Educator of 2011 from Clay County, Ms. Shakima Silvery.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor to be Georgia's Milken Educator for 2011, and it's also an honor to represent Clayton County Public Schools. Quite simply, I do my job because I trust you to do your job, and I know that equality and justice can only be trusted in the hands of the educated. So thank you for having me. God bless you all.
We're about to go on to the rules calendar. Before we take up the rules calendar, the clerk and the chair would remind members that on your desk you have copies of the amended budget bill, HB 74. Those are on your desk. They've been there since early this morning. It is my understanding that we will take that up on the floor tomorrow for consideration. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 763. House Bill 763.
House Bill 763 by Representative Atwood, 179. A bill to be entitled Act entitled 15 related juries, so as to clarify that certain persons shall be ineligible to serve as trial or grand jurors by the use of jurors summoned prior to the compilation of a county master jury list. Revised provisions relating to qualifications of grand jurors. Bill having been before the House Committee on Judiciary, the committee recommends the bill be passed by a committee substitute, and this bill is being read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Representative Atwood to present the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I bring for your favorable consideration by committee substitute, House Bill 763. This bill provides cleanup language to the jury composition bill that was passed late in the session last year. The language was inadvertently deleted. It relates to the qualifications of persons selected to serve as trial and grand jurors. Specifically, it inserts a requirement that any person who has been convicted of a felony in a state or federal court who has not had their rights restored, and any person who has been judicially determined to be mentally incompetent shall not be eligible to serve as trial or grand jurors. It also allows for those summoned for jury service prior to July 1st, 2012, shall remain eligible to comprise the veneer. We're not making any new law here, ladies and gentlemen of the House. We're just inserting existing law. This bill was passed unanimously out of the Judiciary Committee. It has the support of the Judicial Council of Georgia. And with that, Mr. Speaker, I'll yield for questions.
You don't appear to have any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Yield the will.
Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the adoption of the resolution? Chair hears none, and the report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this resolution now be adopted, or this bill now be adopted? All in favor of the adoption of the bill will vote yes. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 763. The ayes are 163, the nays are zero. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. Clerk will read the caption to House Bill 475. House Bill 475.
House Bill 475, Representative Powell, the 171st, a bill entitled Act Title 36, the Development Authorities Law, so as to amend the definition of the term project to include facilities owned by public or private entity or combination to integrate purposes of trade, commerce, industry, employment opportunities, provided that term includes highway facilities, surface transportation projects, and projects that are related to transportation. Bill has been before the House Committee on Economic Development and Tourism. The committee recommends the bill do pass, be read for the third time.
Chair recognizes Chairman Jay Powell to present the bill. Chairman Powell.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I bring to you House Bill 475. This is an amendment to the Statutory Development Authority Law. As many of you know, the current law allows the local community, whether it be a county or a city, to adopt by resolution and establish a development authority to enhance economic development in their community and to bring jobs in their community. What this bill does, this was recommended by the development community in the state of Georgia, plus has been endorsed by numerous development authorities throughout the state, to give them, number one, the ability to do public-private partnerships and transportation projects. The current law applies or says that a development authority can do mass commuting projects, but there's no definition of mass commuting projects in the law. And so this adds a definition. And then the final thing that it does is, since there are public and private components in many of these public-private partnerships, the amendment to the bill, I mean to the statute, provides that in the event that there are public and private components, that, for instance, if there is a multimodal bus terminal being built and there is a office building that is built in conjunction with that, and that may be owned by the public, and then the private entity owns the multimodal facility or a flip-flop of that, that just because there's a standalone office building, if it's determined as an integral part of the whole project, even though it's standalone, it qualifies as a public-private partnership. And the reason that this is important is that in the event that a development authority decides to endorse such a project or finance such a project, it does not need to be halfway through construction or complete with construction and somebody challenge whether there was a standalone facility that was not necessarily integral to the whole project. So it's necessary to give that discretion to the development authority if it in fact is part of the project. So with that explanation, Mr. Speaker, I will yield the well unless there are questions.
You have questions if you care to yield.
I will yield.
Chair recognizes Chairman Houston to your right for a question.
This is not an alimony bill.
No, thank you. This is a friendly question. Do development authorities of this type, will they have the ability to sell bonds?
Well, they currently have the ability to do that. This does not change that aspect of the development authority's law. All it does is provide a definition for mass commuting facilities and also makes clear that public-private partnerships are things that are included within the jurisdiction of development authorities. But it does not change the financing mechanisms that development authorities can use.
All right, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Chair recognizes Chairman Rogers to your right for a question.
To the gentleman in the well, will you yield?
Yes, sir, I do.
On line six, unfeathered authority, will you describe a definition of unfeathered authority, please?
There are numerous provisions in the code that, and it's in a different code section than this one, that say what kind of projects development authorities can finance, whether it be a office building, a nursing home, several other types of projects. And sometimes there's a mix between those two. And the law actually has put in any other type project that the development authority thinks is appropriate, sort of as a catch-all. But what this does is makes clear if there's a mix or if something could fit into one category but not another, or could fit into two different categories, that the development authority is able to choose which one, and that will not be subject to later challenge.
Will you further yield?
Yes, sir.
On line 11, it says, 10-11, it says, decision by the authority shall not be subject to review. I assume, is it not true, this is for projects that may be coming in from another state or entity that don't want to be announced in the media? Is that what that's for?
No, sir. That's dealing with the issue that I was talking about that's in Section 2 of the bill. It's dealing with public-private partnerships, and if there is a public and private component that may be separate but are together integral for part of the project, that if the development authority makes that determination that it's integral, that's not subject to review. That's the part that it's referring to.
Okay.
Not as far as it being open to the public, or this is not some kind of stealth way of getting around open records or open meetings. No, sir.
Further yield for
yes,
one
sir.
More question.
Yes,
on line 55, the authority's right to lease. They do not have that authority now to lease developments, I assume, to a private entity, so this just expands that?
No, sir. As a matter of fact, the next sentence makes it clear that they already have, this is a restatement of existing law,
okay.
And that's already something authorities can do. It's just clarification language.
Thank you.
Chair recognizes the chairman of the Rules Committee to your right for a question.
Calling me, telling me what to do. Would the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
When a development authority, they have the bonding power, do they have to have the approval of the county that they're located in or the city to have that bonding authority?
Well, first of all, they aren't set up without the authority or this enabling resolution by the city or the county. And I think it depends on the kind of bonds that they propose to do. If it's backed by the full faith and credit of the county or the city, then I think they do have to have that approval.
Thank you.
Mr. Speaker, I'll yield the well.
You have other questions if you care to yield.
I'll yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Chair recognizes Representative Hatfield to speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, I rise this morning to discuss a couple of points about this bill because I think that there is a lot of confusion about what the bill means. And to be honest with you, I've got some questions about it myself, but I see some points that I think should be brought to the attention of the body as we look at this. I've had some experience in dealing with development authorities. We've got down in my neck of the woods some development authorities that folks are looking at pretty closely because of some very questionable sorts of projects that have gone on and questionable uses of money. But I look at this bill, and particularly in Section 2, I'm concerned because if you look at subsection B, starting on line 43, it talks about giving the authority the ability to make a determination as to what is a public-private partnership and to determine that there is public participation in it. And then it goes on to say, the authority's determination or determinations as to such matters shall be final for all purposes of this chapter and not subject to review. That's on lines 48 through 50. What concerns me about that is this, is that a project which has maybe perhaps very little public participation in it, which is practically to benefit only a private entity, could then be deemed to be in the public interest by these development authorities that, as you all know, these development authorities around the state, they're not elected officials. These are appointed, unelected officials. They're accountable to no one. They are accountable to no one. And contrary, in response to the rules chairman's question a few minutes ago about the issuance of the bonds, the cities and counties generally are not going to approve or not approve the development authority's issuance of bonds because most of those development authority bonds that are issued are what's not called non-recourse bonds, which means that those purchasers of the bonds can't come back against the cities or the counties. So the cities or counties don't participate in that decision making. Those non-recourse bonds are the types that are issued by the development authorities, and they issue them with no just generally no oversight other than perhaps a perfunctory hearing in Superior Court to for the validation of the bonds. So we've got an unelected body of people that are making decisions to issue what essentially amounts to public monies in the form of these bonds to finance projects that they have the exclusive ability to determine whether or not they're in the public interest. And I think that if you look around the state, you'll start to see, if you look closely at some of these projects, that they're not so much in the public interest as they are in the interests of certain private individuals that are really making out like bandits. And it bothers me that we've got a provision in there in lines 48 through 50 saying the authority's determination or determinations as to such matters shall be final for all purposes of this chapter and not subject to review. Well, what does that mean? Not subject to review by who? Well, who might review a decision like that? If we know that these decisions are not subject to be reviewed by a city or county government, I'll tell you who might review it would be a court. A court might review it. But what I would submit to you that this language is intended to do is to make sure that no court can review it. And if you don't, if you have any hesitancy in believing me in that, I want you to turn over and take a look at page 3 of the bill, section 3. Section 3 of the bill, and it contains what in the legal profession is known as a severability clause. And what that means is, and what it says is, that if any part of this bill is held unconstitutional or invalid, then the other parts will still be upheld. Now, I wonder why that we might have a severability clause in this bill. Do you think it could be because that there might be some anticipation that some court down the line is going to look at that language on lines 48 through 50 and say, hey, it's not constitutional to say that it's not that you can make a non-reviewable decision as to whether or not something's in the public benefit. I submit that that severability clause is there exactly because that language in lines 48 through 50 is there, because they're anticipating that someday down the road, in the course of some lawsuit, a judge is going to say, you can't do that, and that's unconstitutional. So that this severability clause they would use to save the rest of the bill. But let me say this. Look on it at subsection C of the bill, beginning on line 51, going through 59. I think this is potentially opening some really new roads for development authorities. It talks about an authority may issue bonds which shall qualify as paying the cost of a project, one, to purchase or acquire a completed project. And then going on down, if you look at lines 56 through 59, the provisions of this subsection are a restatement of current law. Now, and that, I think, ought to raise a question. It raises a question in my mind. If we're restating current law, why do we need to do that in here? If something's in the law already, why do we need to restate it in a bill? But going on, the provisions or restatement of current law and get this, and shall not be construed to restrict the right of a person or entity to lease a project from an authority when such person or entity is the seller or builder of such project, or when such bonds are issued to such person or entity. Now, what does all that mean? Well, I submit to you, it means just this, that if you've got someone who wants to build a project, a business, an investment that they want to start, then they go to the authority. They say, I'm ready to build this, and I want you, unelected authority members, and your authority to be my bank. I want you public entity, to be my bank. Okay? That's what it means. They come in, they issue bonds, just like in line 59, when the bonds are issued to such person or entity, the bank, the authority is the bank, and it's going to issue the bonds to the seller, they call, or the builder. And what is that, what that person going to do? He's going to build some buildings. He might buy some equipment, buy some capital. And then what does he do? Well, then it's been purchased with this authority money. It's really actually owned by the authority. But here's the trick. Here's the trick. Is that the builder, as you see in lines, lines 55, talking about for the purpose of the authorities leasing, selling, or placing under management any such project. What the authority does is they turn around and they lease it back to the builder. Okay, you got that? They lease it back to the builder. Okay, now why would they do that? Why would they do that? Think about it. I'll tell you why they do that. And this is going on all over this state, folks. It's the biggest scam going in the state of Georgia today. Why they do that is because that builder and his building or his business that he's built is not on the tax rolls. He's sitting there running a business tax free. They don't pay a dime. It's not wrong, it's right. They sit there and they run a business tax free. And what they do is they continue to operate under a lease for however many years. And at the end of that lease, you know what they get to do in a lot of these situations? They get to buy it for a dollar or $10, $50. That's the ugly truth of it, folks. There may be those that don't say, that say otherwise, and they can have at it. But I've seen it. We know it's going on all over the state. It's the biggest scam going. And I'd ask you not to contribute to allowing this to go further. Because before this session's over, I got some information about some authorities that I want to share with you. But I will tell you this. If you vote for this bill, you're making a mistake. You're enabling people that are not doing good things for the taxpayers of this state. You're voting for a bad bill. Thank you. I yield the will.
You have questions if you care to answer them. It's up to you.
I'll yield.
Chair recognizes the majority leader of the House for a question to your right.
Thank you. Would the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
I want to make sure I understood what you just said when you alleged that the operator, the owner of the property that's bonded operates tax-free. Did I hear that statement correctly?
Ad valorem tax-free.
Okay, so you're not aware then that the valuation is based on the leasehold interest through the pass-through entity of the development authorities, and tax, although lessened to attract business, like for instance in my county, to bring 1,700 new jobs in with Frito-Lay Corporation under the same scenario, they pay a huge amount of ad valorem tax based on their leasehold interest, which is completely contrary to the statement you just made.
Well,
is that not true?
Let's say, Mr. Leader, with all due respect, you know, the idea that they're coming in and creating all these jobs, there are, I'm sure, instances around the state where some of these projects do create a lot of jobs. But I can show you some instances of where the state, and I'm not just talking about the local governments, but our state government had put millions of dollars into some of these projects, and the jobs that they created ain't what was advertised. And so I understand your concern. I would say every project that's come out of one of these development authorities is a bad thing, but I'm telling you there is an abuse of the system here.
You have other questions if you care to yield.
I'll yield.
Chair recognizes Chairman Knight for a question back to your left.
Does the gentleman yield?
Yes, sir.
Isn't it true that my community, my development authority actually votes on and to allow the exclusion of property taxes? That is something that is taken up by the actual authority. Furthermore, I know my authority does not waive school taxes. And I would agree also, isn't it true that there are property taxes, as the leader said, paid on these leases and on the equipment in them?
Well, I think that you hit on the operative issue, and that is, what does the authority do about the tax situation? Maybe your authority that you're referring to is doing it the right way, but I'll guarantee you that for every one that's doing it the right way, there's four or five others that are not. And I am talking about situations where the authorities, these are non or unelected officials, appointed officials, accountable to no one, that are granting these tax abatements and granting people the right to run these businesses built with public monies, funded with public monies, and then they're granting them the right to run them tax-free, ad valorem tax-free, not sales taxes or anything like that, but ad valorem tax-free.
I respect the gentleman's comment. I would disagree in my case. They are paying ad valorem taxes. Furthermore, isn't the financing, the bonds that are issued, isn't this also an incentive in a way in which we can incentivize businesses coming in and perhaps obtain a smaller or a lesser interest rate? And isn't this an incentive by which we can bring businesses into our community by helping them find a smaller interest rate?
It is, respectfully I say, it is absolutely an incentive. It's an incentive, all right. It you know, the question is, who is it an incentive for? And then what does that incentive produce? Because your average small business person is not going to have a chance at these sorts of things. These are going to be for business. We're talking about multi-million dollar efforts in most instances. But the problem is that once these things are done, they're done with an understanding that these jobs are going to be created. X number of jobs are going to be created. I mean, you've all seen the headlines in your papers. I mean, the local paper comes out and says, XYZ Corporation's opening up here. The development authority's made it happen. They're going to create 1,000 new jobs. And then everybody's just, oh, yeah, awesome, good for us, pat ourselves on the back. But then nobody, and everybody's like, yo, hey, it's out there now, they're up and running, we got 1,000 new jobs, but nobody ever follows up. But a year down the line, year and a half, well, how come there's only about 25 cars out there in the parking lot? Why is only 25 cars out there? There's supposed to be 1,000 new jobs. What? Hey, let me tell you, it's the biggest scam going in this state.
Well, to the gentleman, I respect his thoughts, but I will tell you that for my community, it has meant thousands of jobs that have come into my community through the work of my development authority. It has meant millions of dollars that has been added to the tax rolls, especially for our school system, and it's put a lot of people, thousands of people, to work, because my development authority, I know, has done it the right way.
Okay, well, come hang with me sometime and I'll show you some. Mr. Speaker, I yield the will.
The gentleman has yielded the will. Chair recognizes Chairman Stevens to speak to the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I won't take but just a minute here. I just wanted to clear the air just a little bit. We ought to be consistent in this House. Just 2 years ago, I brought a bill to you to allow the Georgia Ports Authority to issue their own bonds. They back their own bonds. Not one dime of the bonds that they back is backed, or even with one single permission of an elected official. Ladies and gentlemen, this is not new stuff. This is a very, very good bill, and it will create jobs in a public-private way for transportation specifically. Vote for this bill. If you voted for the Georgia Ports bill, you ought to vote for this bill. Mr. Speaker, I yield the will.
You had questions, but the gentleman has yielded the will. No further speakers. Is there any objection? What purpose does Representative Jurgensen rise?
Parliamentary inquiry.
State your inquiry.
Mr. Speaker, I'm trying to get my hands around the different sections of this bill. And in clarification, isn't it true that in line 26, that line 26 refers to a private entity? And then in line 43, that the authority has exclusive decision making to determine what a project is. And then in line 51, they may issue bonds to possibly construct on that private piece of property.
Every member has a copy of the bill at their desk, and the author is sitting down front to your left. If you want to talk to him about clarification, I think that'd be the proper way, Representative.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
What purpose does Representative Williams rise?
Parliamentary inquiry.
State your inquiry.
Mr. Speaker, is it not so that there are many authorities in Georgia that are not elected by the voters, such as Board of Regents, big boards that spend a lot of money, and have they not been successful?
I'm sure the gentleman knows whereof he speaks.
Is it not further true, Mr. Speaker, that to accuse authorities of being scam artists and only one out of five being honest, is that not playing a little loose with the numbers?
I think that's going to be a judgment to be made by each and every member of this body. What purpose does Representative Drenner rise?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Parliamentary
inquiry. State your inquiry.
Mr. Speaker, is it not true that I'd like to echo the comments by Representative Williams that there are other authorities in this state that are constituted by unelected officials?
I'm sure that you know that about which you speak.
Further inquiry, Mr. Speaker, lastly, that sometimes is it not true that taking politics out of decisions is a good thing?
I'm going to let each and every member make that determination. I'm trying to figure out how to take politics out of a lot of things. But what purpose does Representative Sims rise?
Parliamentary inquiry.
State your inquiry.
Mr. Speaker, I understand, is it not true, of both sides of this issue, it's a great economic tool in order to abate the tax. Is that not true? And also, shouldn't there be, though, a limit for the length of time someone could abate the tax, and if they were left before that time period ended, that they could go back against that company or business for the amount of tax that does occur? That's, I think that's where Mr. Hatfield's coming from, and that's happened in several incidences in all over the state. Is that not true?
I'm sure you know that about which you speak. For what purpose does Representative Battles rise?
Parliamentary inquiry.
State your inquiry.
Is it not true that these authorities, which I serve on not only in the county but also the Joint Development Authority, are open meetings to not only the public but also the press, and it is not done in secret?
I think that gentleman is correct. All right, we've had a good, healthy debate. Is there any objection to the previous question being ordered? The chair hears none. The previous question is ordered. Is there any objection to adopting the committee substitute? The chair hears none. The committee substitute is adopted. Is there any objection to agreeing to the report of the committee, which was favorable to the bill? Chair hears none. The report of the committee is agreed to. Shall this bill now pass? All those in favor of the passage of House Bill 475 will vote yes. Those opposed will vote no, and the clerk will unlock the machines. Have all members voted? Have all members voted? Have all members voted? If so, the clerk will lock the machine on the passage of House Bill 475. The ayes are 132. The nays are 28. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed. What purpose does Representative Murphy rise?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to make a motion, please.
State your motion.
Sir, I am requesting that House Bill 652 be transferred from Government Affairs to Intergovernmental Coordination, and both chairmen have agreed.
Clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 652, Representative Murphy, the 120th, bill to be entitled Act Provide for an Advisory Referendum Election to be held in Augusta, Richmond County.
On the motion of the gentleman that House Bill 652 be withdrawn from the Governmental Affairs Committee and recommitted to the Intergovernmental Coordination Committee, is there objection? The chair hears none. It is so ordered. Chair recognizes Representative McKillop for a motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that this House insist on its position on House Bill 129 and a committee of conference be appointed.
Clerk will read the caption.
House Bill 129, Representative McKillop, 115th. The bill will be entitled Act Amending Title 44, relating generally to mortgages, conveyance of secured debt, and liens, so as to prohibit a fee for future conveyance of real property except under limited circumstances.
Chair recognizes Representative McKillop to explain his motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Bill 129 passed out of this House late last session. It was, in fact, the bill that was being debated on the floor of the Senate when the gavel fell. The Senate had lit it up like a Christmas tree with amendments over there, and we have had them disagree to bring it back over here. We'd like to appoint a committee of conference to strip it down to the original bill that this House passed and give them another chance to pass what we did. Happy to answer any questions.
You have no questions.
I yield the will.
Gentleman yields the will. On the motion of the gentleman that House Bill that this House insist on its position on House Bill 129 and that a committee of conference be appointed. Is there objection? Chair hears none. It is so ordered. This House has insisted on its position, and the chair appoints as a committee of conference on House Bill 129. Representative McKillop, Representative Jacobs, and Representative Allison. This House will come to order. House will come to order. All members that are on the floor of the House, for the next minute or two, I want you to go to your seats and take your seats and cease conversation. We're going to recognize one of the greatest members that ever served in this body. I think he was Rules Committee Chairman for about 50 years or close to it, or maybe it just seemed that way. I can tell you that on the one or two times I went to the House Rules Committee in his era, my knees were trembling and I could hardly stand. I was in awe of this man, but he was always a gentleman and was always very fair, and he loved this House of Representatives. And let's welcome back to this chamber former Rules Committee Chairman Bill Lee.
Good morning. I'm not sure you're looking any better, but I'm glad to be here. Yeah, it's a wonderful day. Hope you're all doing all right. I read about you in the paper. Some of it's pretty good. Some of it ain't very good. But we're going to make it. We're going to make it. And good day, and God bless you. Thank you.
We're almost through, and I don't want members leaving, but I'm going to pause here for a minute or two because I know many of you will want to say hello to Chairman Lee. Okay, let's come back to order. House will come back to order. The clerk will read the caption to a group of privilege resolutions. If you have an announcement and have signed up for an announcement, you need to come down to the front. We're going to start those here momentarily. Clerk will read the caption to a group of privilege resolutions.
A resolution by Representative Rogers, 26, convening the Georgia Institute of Technology for the G. Wayne Clow Georgia Tech Promise Scholarship. A resolution by Representative Dickerson, 95th, recognizing Bald Rock Baptist Church. A resolution by Representative Purcell, 159, honoring and commending the firefighters of Georgia, recognizing February 7, 2012, as the 40th Annual Firefighters Appreciation Day at the Capitol. Resolution by Representative Purcell, 159, committing Emergency Management Agency of Georgia, recognizing February 8, 2012, Georgia Emergency Management Agency GEMA Recognition Day at the Capitol. Resolution by Representative Purcell, 159, committing the Emergency Medical Services Professionals of Georgia, and recognizing February 8, 2012, as Emergency Medical Services Day at the Capitol. Resolution by Representative Burns, 157, recognizing February 8, 2012, as Sportsman's and Coastal Day at the Capitol. And a resolution by Representative Dickerson, 95th, recognizing February 16, 2012, as Eagle Scout and Gold Award Scout Day at the Capitol through the privilege resolutions.
Is there objection to adoption of the privilege resolutions? The chair hears none. The resolutions are adopted. Okay, we're going on to announcements. Chair recognizes Chairman Benton for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I wanted to remind the members of the House Human Relations and Aging Committee we will be meeting this afternoon at 3:30, room 515, CLOB. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Chairman Knight for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to remind everyone that today is the first hearing committee meeting that we're going to have with the Special Committee on Small Business Development and Job Creation, CLOB, room 406, 1 to 4 p.m. I want to remind you, we are having constituents, Georgia citizens from all over the state coming in to testify today on regulations that we need to look at. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Chairman Parsons for an announcement. Chairman Parsons.
Thank you, Speaker. Thank you, Speaker. The Energy, Utilities, and Telecom Committee is meeting today at 2 o'clock in room 403 here in the Capitol. It's here in the Capitol, room 403. I expect to see all the members there. Thank you. Thank you, Speaker.
Chair recognizes Representative Bell for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I want to remind the DeKalb County Commissioners that the DeKalb County Redistricting Committee for the Commissioners that we are meeting today, 1:30 in room 514 of the CLOB. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Representative Wilkerson for an announcement.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Democratic House Caucus is having a hearing on jobs and economic security at 3 p.m. in room 230. Thank you.
That completes the announcements. Chair recognizes the Majority Leader of the House for a motion. Listen up.
Mr. Speaker, I move that this House now stand in recess until 5 p.m. today, at which time we shall adjourn until 9 a.m. Let me repeat, 9 a.m. Friday, tomorrow morning, February 3rd, 2012.
On the motion of the Majority Leader of the House that this House recess until 5 o'clock p.m. today and then stand adjourned until Friday, February the 3rd at 9 a.m. All those in favor of the motion say aye. All those opposed will say no. The ayes have it. This House will be in recess until 5 o'clock p.m. today, and then will be adjourned until 9 o'clock a.m. tomorrow, Friday, February the 3rd.